I don't have a smartphone. I don't know if the chief knows about operating. We can find a Wi-Fi here.
Thanks, Sheriff. Good evening. I'm Kevin Porter, Chairman of the Board. I'd like to welcome you to, can you hear me now? All right. Sorry about that. I'm Kevin Corbin, Chairman of the Board of Macon County Commissioners. We're thrilled that you chose to come this way this evening. This is our regular County Commission meeting held on the second Tuesday of each month at Chester 5 West Main Street. I believe the address here. So we're 28734. So we're glad to have you guys. Well, as always. First of all, any announcements that any board members want to make?
Mr. Chairman, as these on the Sheriff's Department, as you know, this past week we averted what everybody suspects and appears could have been a very, very tragic day in Macon County. The Sheriff is here, and there's many responsible folks that helped in this day, but it did turn into a tragedy that we all went through. And a lot of folks were involved. Civilians and, of course, our trade folks at the Sheriff's Department. So, before we have a moment of silence, everyone in the room needs to be certainly thankful that that life service is not a day that will go down and be remembered forever. So, Sheriff, you'll come by and come on up. And this is an ongoing investigation, Sheriff, and we've talked hours upon hours, as the Chairman and you and I have, and we know that there's no limit on what you can say. But I think what needs to come from each one of us, and we all may want to speak to that. We can thank the Macon Sheriff's Department.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
So, if you want to give a report on where we stand today and say whatever you need to.
Actually, what I would like to do is I'm not going to give any details in reference to the case. What I would like to say is, during that morning, we had a lot of heroes. From the get-go, we have said that the bus driver, Miss Alice Bradley, has been a hero. She will always go down as a hero in my book, and all the officers within the Macon County Sheriff's Office for her action. Secondly, while I've named her, there's multiple officers that responded to that scene that morning to assist Miss Bradley and also are heroes. And the one thing that I want to take away from this is while Miss Bradley and my officers don't really want to be considered heroes and will tell you that, I'm sure, there was a lot of people throughout that day, through the course of this entire situation, dispatchers, highway patrol, Franklin Police Department, the school system, teachers, custodians, a wide variety of individuals who all live within our county and work for different organizations. And I'm extremely proud of them. I'm honored to be associated, to be a part with any single one of them. And I hope at the appropriate time that we will be able to tell you the facts of the case and what actually transpired. I consider myself to be very, very blessed to be able to talk to you tonight in a positive way and not have to stand here before you because of a tragedy that has occurred. I shiver to think of what could have happened if this event would have occurred an hour and a half later. It scares me to death. You all, every single one of you sitting here, has supported our SROs. While an SRO wasn't involved with that actual first confrontation or second confrontation, they were very active throughout all of our school system that day and there at the school doing things that we have to do. And you all have supported the School Resource Officers Program in our county. And so you too are a part of being recognized when we do recognize what everybody has done, because if not for the support of your commission as well as previous commissions that we have fought for SROs all along, we wouldn't have been able to do what we've done. So, in short, I appreciate that, and I don't want to go into details. Our priority is now prosecuting this case, but I look forward to the day of being able to tell you what this bus driver and these five officers did. I'm extremely proud of them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We walk away thankful.
Blessed.
And we walk away blessed. And we walk away understanding that the phrase, "it can't happen here," is not appropriate or accurate. And I'm glad that we had not only a bus driver, but some law enforcement folks that reacted quickly. And from the board picture, we want to thank all those involved. And Robbie and I had the opportunity to have lunch today, and we talked about it at a time somewhere in the future. The appropriate time is not now. But there will be appropriate time in the future that we'll recognize that was involved and all the facts can be told. And, so just make a note that we will do that. And so I'm sure you and our superintendent and the county manager can have a conversation about that. And we'll need that matter before. Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Tate. We do have as far as announcements go, we have a short video from the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. Of course, this is the larger group that we belong to statewide. All 100 counties are part of this, and we're proud that our own Ronnie Beal is actually the president of that group this year. His term ends in August. Done a great job and been a busy year. So, Mike, if you would, we'll take a look at that video. If you would turn the lights back out, we have some time.
Welcome to the June 2015 update video from the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. We create this video on a recurring basis to help keep commissioners and county staff up to speed on the work your association is doing on your behalf. Since our last update, your association staff has been busy on many fronts, and your board of directors has been working hard on strategic planning. Let's begin this update with our biggest advocacy event of the year, County Assembly Day, which was held in early May. More than 200 county commissioners, managers, finance officers, and other county officials from across the state gathered in Raleigh to advocate for county's goals. Attendees heard from Governor Pat McCrory, Senate President Pro Tem Phil Berger, and Speaker of the House Tim Moore during the morning session. And then the crowd of over 200 went down Jones Street to discuss county's priorities with legislators. The day saw much success as many legislators heard face-to-face about county's goals and how proposed legislation would affect counties. If you weren't able to make it to County Assembly Day, many of the day's presentations are available via recorded video on the NCACC website.
Hi, I'm Lauren Petamino with Local Government Federal Credit Union. LGFCU is proud to sponsor the 2015 Excellence in Innovation Awards. Administered by the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, the Excellence in Innovation Awards program provides a total of $10,000 in awards to county employees who develop successful programs that help counties improve services to citizens. Cash awards of $1,000 each are given to two or more programs in each of four categories: general government, health and human services, public information and participation, and intergovernmental collaboration. The rules and official application form can be found under Risk Management and Member Services menu at www.ncacc.org. If you have any questions or comments about the Local Government Federal Credit Union Excellence in Innovation Awards Program, please contact Membership Services Coordinator Matt Gunnett at 919-715-2354 or at the email on your screen.
As we begin summer, it's that time of year again to begin registering for the NCACC Annual Conference. You should have already received an email from us highlighting some conference events and giving you links to sign up. Managers and clerks also receive this information, just in case we missed you. In addition, you'll be receiving a mailing in the near future with the information on it as well. We always love to see as many commissioners and county staff as possible at annual conference, and the 108th Annual Conference in Pitt County promises to be another unique and well-planned educational experience for all who can attend. We hope to see you there. You can find more information on the conference, or you can sign up by visiting www.ncacc.org/annual-conference. In April, your NCACC Board of Directors made the trek up to Macon County, home of NCACC President Ronnie Bill, to move forward the strategic planning process. That meeting was very productive, and the association's first mission statement was crafted at the meeting. Many of the board's members left that retreat with a newfound appreciation for what the association does for its members. And they seized the opportunity to shape the association's marching orders for the next decade and beyond. The meeting was historic, both because of its location and its purpose. The association's first mission statement, the reworking of the association's strategic plan, and the first meeting held as far west as Macon County all made it unique. The finalized strategic plan will be presented to the NCACC membership in August at the 2015 annual conference in Pitt County. In another agenda item, the board made the decision not to raise membership dues for counties for the seventh consecutive year. The association welcomed Research Director Linda Millsaps at the end of April. Millsaps will head up the initiative to expand the association's research capabilities. Look for more on this front over the months to come as she works to make changes in the information and research the association has available for its members. Finally, let's talk about risk management. The risk management team has had a great renewal season this year. Perhaps the best news for risk pool members is that the Risk Management Board of Trustees was able to avoid raising rates for the fourth year in a row. Well, that's all we have for this month, but you can find more on any of the association's activities at ncacc.org. As always, feel free to contact us with questions. You can email communications@ncacc.org or call 919-715-2893. Thank you for this opportunity to keep you informed, and thank you for your membership and participation in the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners.
Okay, thank you, Mike. Sorry about the sound. Can you hear that okay? We'll work on that. And we're glad that the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners board meeting was able to be held here. They've always thought that this area was the part that Rand McNally cuts off and sticks under Charlotte. We finally were able to explain to them that it's actually part of the western part of the state, so I think they get that now that we're where we live and begin to make some inroads. Anyway, it's a great organization. We're glad to be a part of it. As Commissioner Beal said, we will observe a moment of silence, so I'd ask you to stand in silence and spend that moment how you'd like. I ask Commissioner Shields to lead their pledge of allegiance after the moment. Thank you, Mr. Shields.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I did have one announcement. I say this for now. I've got Mr. Jack Devlin. Where's Jack? Well, Jack, there he is. Jack Devlin is a Department of Transportation board member for District 14, and he was appointed by Governor McCrory recently to that post. And so I asked Jack if he would come and take just a couple of minutes and speak to us about some things. We'll let you know who he was. You need to know who he is. An important guy in our region. He is our contact with DOT. So, and former chairman of the board of Jackson County Commissioners. So, Jack, welcome.
Thank you, Commissioners. Mr. Corbin, Ronnie. Somebody said you needed a friend.
Yes, sir.
So I came on.
I did. Thanks for coming.
I wanted to talk to you a little bit and introduce myself. I am Jack Devnum, and appointed March 30th by Governor McCrory to represent Division 14, which is Polk, Henderson, Transylvania, Haywood, everything west. So I have a rather large district. cover, but I wanted to make it a point to come and visit every board of commissioners, and this won't be the last time you'll see me. I intend to do this job as I have done everything else that I've been involved in. But I want to talk a little bit about some Macon County projects, just bring you up to date on a few. Project number R5115 is the truck signage and turnaround in the Colasage Gorge. It's approximately 85% through, should be completed by January of 16. Project number W5214H is an access management project on 23441 at Cat Creek. It has been under construction for about 2 weeks and is expected to be completed in November. Project 5103 is a renovation of the rest area at the Georgia line. That's expected to be completed on 5/22/15, which would run a little back. Bridge replacement on LJ and Short Arm Roads are projects are about 15% complete with the April 16 completion date. Bridge project on Poplar Cove is under contract. Work has not yet started. It has a completion date of May the 16th of 2016. Bridge replacement on Wallace Branch was completed in May. Bridge replacement projects on Mulberry and Lake and Lackey Creek roads are approximately 60% completed with completion date April 2016. Wells Grove Road turn lane projects are expected to begin later this summer. Some significant future projects, US 19 from the Swain County line to Topton will be repaved. That contract is to be let in July. Resurfacing NC 28 from Macon Plaza to 441 Business, and then 441 Business eastbound only from United Community Bank is to be let later on this month. Project number B3868, the McCoy Bridge, will be let November 17th. B5125, the Henson Bridge, will be let August of 16. R5734, access management on 441 South from 64 to Wide Horizon Drive. We are supposed to engage local officials June 22nd to discuss this project. And U5604 is the intersection improvements on 441 Business at Maple Street and Wyatt and Porter Street. Division will be engaging officials June 22nd also to discuss that project. That project is currently not on the schedule to be done until 2022. I also wanted to talk to you, you gentlemen, a little bit about a lot of people still think the DOT has a lot of control about what happens in the area with the implement of the STIP program and the point system. If you're passionate about a project, attend your RPO meetings, your regional planning organizations, and voice your opinion at those meetings, because if you don't get on the list from the RPO, you're not on the list, and you have, I'm being blunt, no future of getting on that list at any time soon. So become involved with your rural planning organization. Do attend those and voice the past head of Division 14 had at his discrepancy over $1 million. I have $125,000 in my budget now. So there's not much I can do at my, but become involved. Stay involved with this whole transportation project. Support the governor's bond issues. If we can get those big projects out of the way, and it's like Mr. Beal said, it's the 80-20 thing. 80% is going to 20 counties, but if we can get those big projects out of the way, hopefully we can get some money back out this way. And that's my report for the evening. And I do appreciate you letting me come out and introduce myself and call me anytime.
Okay.
You know. So
let me just say a word about Jack Denton. We've served together on RPO for many years. Jack has always been an advocate for better roads in our area, and we're certainly glad to be in a position he's in. He'll be a good voice for us. He went back up. We appreciate it.
Well, there's five criteria that we have, and I'll explain. We don't have a port out here, so we don't get any points for that. We don't have an airport with a regular scheduled flight, with regular flight schedules, so we don't get any additional points for that. And we don't have a military base. So out of the five criteria, we're already down to two is the only thing we get points about. But I know Ronnie will. I'm surprised they showed the video of him not saying something. I was really surprised. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, Jack. We appreciate that. Jack is an advocate for our area, and he and I talk about regularly. And I've got his cell phone number if necessary. So, thank you.
Chairman, would you entertain a very quick comment?
Very quick, because we need to move very quickly.
The walk across the Henson Bridge, August 2015. The last time I was better, the August 2015.
All right.
My contact information is available online. That's the phone to ring. Give me a call.
Thank you, Jack. We appreciate your time and appreciate you being here very much. We have a public hearing scheduled tonight for our budget, and I'll give you a quick civics lesson for those of you that aren't familiar with North Carolina law and how budgets work. We met in January, February as a board with our county manager, and had some general discussions about budget, about sort of where we wanted to go. And a lot of that discussion was about we wanted to keep the revenue neutral tax rate. What does that mean? In a nutshell, we're not going to pass along any additional tax burden to the taxpayers as far as ad valorem taxes. And we expressed that to him, and he's done that. Fortunately, we've had a small increase in sales tax revenue, which we hope that continues until it's time to states to take away from us, but that's another story for another day. But we began that process in January, February. Then our county manager meets with different department heads, meets with outside agencies, those folks who have a request in for budget line items. He then puts together a budget, presents that to us in May, which he did, gave his budget message with that budget, explaining why he had certain line items in there, and explaining why there were certain amounts, so on and so forth. And then we're required by, well, we met, and then we had a budget work session, and we worked, all of us, I think, individually have met with the county manager, asked questions, gone through budget line items, so on and so forth. Then we had a rather lengthy budget work session, and that was several weeks ago, I lost track of time, but then we set the public hearing for tonight, and this is when we hear from you. It's what you think it is, it's a hearing. It's when we sit and listen, and listen to what you have to say about the budget. So I've asked, in going through this, we had four folks to sign up to speak, and I don't know about the other board members. Actually, all the calls and emails I got regarding the budget from the library. So I asked Derek to give us some detail about exactly, we wanted to see in detail exactly what was in there about the library budget, what it was, the different line items, what they are for, and give us a little bit of commentary on that as far as clarification. Maybe that will help you guys understand what is in the budget. So, Mr. Manager, if you would, we'll give you the floor for just a moment. Well, actually, we'll declare the hearing.
I was going to say, you need to open that public hearing.
We'll open. The public hearing is open, and we'll recognize our county manager, as I've asked to speak to the library tonight. And we've got colleagues coming, Kristen Darty, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. And Maggie Kennedy. Now, are you, you're together? I'm going to sort of figure that out. I did ask them if they could duplicate that hairdo with me, and they said they could. So, you guys are together. Then we have Karen Wallace on there, and we have Norio Kirkland, and then we have Melody and
Rigel.
Okay? And you're speaking together? Okay, does anyone else want to speak to the public here, not about the library, about anything? We didn't have anybody else sign up.
Mr. Commissioner, I was late. Bill Van Horn, I'd like to make a couple of comments about the library, please.
Okay, glad you too. Okay, Mr. Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Board, and it is clear to see by the attendance here tonight, as I assume that most are here in support of the library, and that is great. It shows the support for the library in our community, and as the chairman said, he had asked me to take a look, of our library support and kind of analyze my budget request and provide some justification behind that budget request. And during the budget process, I spoke, as I do on a regular basis, with county managers and in regards to library funding, and as we, Swain County, Jackson County, and Macon County are all members of the Fontana Regional Library System. So when we discuss each year, the 2 years that I've done it, I've called around and had discussions with county managers regarding funding levels. I did the same this year as we were putting together the budget, and I just took an opportunity tonight to formalize that and kind of let you see where I was coming from in the budget process. And just as each and every person here is in support of the Fontana Regional Library and recognizes the resource that it is for our community and the asset that it is for the citizens from his age to your age, Commissioner Hickman. from young to old, the library definitely provides a valuable resource for our citizens, and I think all of us are in agreement here tonight with that. So, first and foremost, I'd like to emphasize that the fiscal year 15-16 budget does not cut funding to the library. It appropriates $999,390, and that is the same level that was appropriated in 14-15. And as I said earlier, it was important when I looked at this appropriation and looked at our budget overall and started comparing it to the counties that also participate in the Fontana Regional Library System, just where are we in comparison to those counties? How much does Macon County support the library in comparison to Jackson County and Swain County, who are also a part of this system? And I figured that would provide a good baseline and a good representation of where we currently stand. And in running those numbers, I came up with the following. I apologize. This is small. I will have copies available for anybody that would like one. But I'll go over what is on this sheet here. The Macon County fiscal year 15-16 recommended budget is $46,646,357. Out of that, $999,390 goes to the Fontana Regional Library System. That is 2.1% of the overall fiscal year 15-16 budget that goes to the libraries, to the Fontana Regional Library System, out of Macon County's budget. What does this break down to? When you look at the 2010 census that is provided, go online, 33,922 people in Macon County, that equates to about $29.40 a person that per capita that Macon County contributes to the Fontana Regional Library System. When we go to Jackson County, the fiscal year 15-16 recommended budget for Jackson County was $56,235,009. Of this budget, $1,015,831 goes to the Fontana Regional Library System. That is 1.8% of their overall budget that goes to the Fontana Regional Library System, or $25.2 a person in Jackson County. I spoke with Darlene Fox yesterday, who is the finance director for Jackson County regarding this, and Jackson County actually, in their proposed budget, has proposed a $46,145 increase over their fiscal year 14-15 levels. And as Darlene was talking about this increase, she informed me that primarily Jackson County's increase was to get the salaries of Jackson County library workers in line with the salaries in Macon County. When you go to Swain County, the recommended fiscal year 15-16 budget in Swain County is $14,300,000. Of that, approximately $200,000 goes to the Fontana Regional Library System. This is 1.4% of the overall budget in Swain County that goes to the Fontana Regional Library System, or $14.3 a person using the population figures from the 2010 census. I got these numbers from County Manager Kevin King. He was on the road to Raleigh. These numbers are not exact, the $14.3 million and $200,000, but they're pretty close. And he was confident that I could use these numbers and have that representation. He just didn't have the budget right in front of him. In addition, that is just these figures that I just went over is just the $999,390 appropriation to the Fontana Regional Library System. In addition to that appropriation, which is 2.1% of our budget, on top of that, Macon County provides an additional $475,370 to the Fontana Regional Library each year. And I'll tell you how that happens. As the library was constructed in 2005, we're still making an annual principal and interest payment of $371,658 annually. Macon County Library, we provide the maintenance workers, one and a half maintenance workers. Currently, we have three maintenance workers that are at the Early College, SEC, and Macon County Library. If you take, they stay out there full time, and their maintenance responsibilities are solely those three buildings. So if you take the salary of one and a half of those maintenance workers, salary and benefits, you get $61,875. Macon County pays the water and sewer bill for the Macon County Library at $3,895. Macon County pays the electricity bill for the library in Franklin. And again, the water and sewer bill, that is the Franklin Library, $26,111. We pay to the Franklin Library in electricity per year. And the Hudson Library water and sewer bill in Highlands, we pay $11,831, and that is inclusive of water, sewer, and electricity. So in addition to that, we also provide maintenance as needed to the library in Nantahala. So when you total all that up and you add that additional $475,370 that is not reflected in that allocation of $999,390, it comes to $1.4 million. That Macon County each year is contributing to the Hudson Library. Again, this is not, or to the, excuse me, to the Fontana Regional Library System. Again, this is not a reduction in funding. And when you take all that into consideration, that $1.4 million then becomes 3.2% of our overall $46 million budget, or about $43.40 per capita that we contribute to the library system in Macon County. I think this shows more than anything, at 2.1% of the overall budget with that allocation. You go to Jackson County, that's 1.8% of their overall budget. If you go to Swain County, that's 1.4% of their overall budget. Again, we're at $29.40 a person with that hard number, $999,000 allocation. Jackson County is at $25.20 a person, nearly $4 less than us, and Swain County contributes approximately $15 per person less than us based on their appropriation to the Fontana Regional Library System when compared to ours. So I hope more than anything, by taking these numbers and breaking it down like this, you can see that Macon County is a leader in the region in terms of our contribution to the library. It's clear that with this contribution, just as our contribution to the school system, that education and the welfare of our citizens, which is directly attributable to things like education and the ability to go into a brand new facility, or it's aging now, 10 years old, but a newly constructed facility. It's not as old as Jackson County's library, the old courthouse, but it shows our commitment and our continued commitment to the Fontana Regional Library System in Macon County. And that is just what I've put together, Mr. Chairman. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Any questions?
Thanks a lot, Alex.
Can you blow that up a little bit? Or that is big as you make
it? I believe.
We'll make copies of that.
Yes, we can do that. I can go get copies of this during
break, or
I can have copies for everybody to distribute. Wherever.
Thank you.
Any other questions, comments? Next year, how we just make sure we do exactly what kind of numbers that we had in the budget, exactly what was there. And again, we have Kristen and Maggie. And just rules, this is not my rules, it's Macon County rules, 5 minutes allocated. You can't pass that on to another speaker. So you've got 5 minutes, now that's for attorney to be the timekeeper, it'll be the bad guy, not me. And as you remember in your school presentation, you keep things to the point and make your point short. So you've got 5 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Kristen Dando, and this is Maggie Kennedy. And if you can't tell, we work with children. I work in the children's section of the library. So thanks for letting us do our spiel here. Hello, Macon County. We're thing one and thing two. And we're glad to be here to visit with you.
You support our three libraries we know, and we're giddy that we can be open for seniors and parents and kiddies.
We're grateful, believe us, but we need a bit more. We ask for an increase, and the percent is just 4.
Our libraries lack copiers. We need laptops for classes. Our printers are dying, and our servers are crashing.
You're trying, we know, but after inflation took hold, our equipment and holds have grown really old.
But thing one, Cat in the Hat, can fix things like that! Why can't Macon do something like that?
It's true. The citizens are speaking. They're reading like crazy. Our people want books. It's fine and amazing.
We need e-books and large print and bestsellers, don't you see? We need magazines and movies and some books on CD.
They're good, books and tools, and it's certain we need those. But who will help us serve? Who's on their toes?
Our library staff. Know the ins and the outs. They find all the things you need to be learning about.
Now they need a small raise, a bit of a boost. They've been falling behind cost of living through the roof.
Without some more funding, we won't be the same. Cuts to our hours and service will only cause pain.
People are yearning for learning. They're reading for fun. A little more funding will make the library run.
There'll be points to be scored. There are games to be won.
Thing two, you're in the wrong book.
But thing one, in our story, we get caught in the net by the Cat in the Hat. And locked in a box with a fox, no socks.
But when our libraries are saved by a little more spending, we can all celebrate with a much happier ending.
Thank you.
Staff of the library. I want to thank you for listening to our concerns. We realize that there are many needs to be met in Macon County, and that the Board of Commissioners has difficult funding decisions to make. And I do want to clarify, it's come to my attention that some of the contacts that were made to our Board of Commissioners were from our supporters, indicating that we had suggested there was a cut in the budget. And at no point did we ever suggest to our supporters or to anyone that you were recommending a cut for us. So our apologies if that is the message that you got, and you are welcome to see all of the correspondence that we put out to our supporters to clarify that. So I would like to recognize all of those people who are here in support of the library.
Woo!
I see some out the door as well. We appreciate you being here to show your support. The library provides vital services to all the citizens of Macon County, regardless of age, regardless of education, regardless of income level. The number of people using library services continues to grow. Over the past 8 years, and that is, the library is 8 years old at this point, in the new building, the number of people with active library cards, and these aren't just anybody who's ever gotten a library card, active library cards has grown to over 31,000 people. And I think you heard from Mr. Rowland what the population of Macon County is, so that's a pretty astounding figure to have.
Macon County, right?
Those are Macon County citizens or people who own property or work in Macon County. They have a connection to Macon County. A quarter of a million people visited the libraries in Macon County last year during the 6,400 hours that the libraries were open. And even more people are utilizing the digital resources that we have, which are available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Since 2008, when we moved into the new building, the rate of inflation has increased by 10%. County funding to the library has increased by only 4%. But we've been providing more services to more people. And while it's true, and we certainly appreciate the funds that the county gives us of almost $1 million, as you heard from Mr. Rowland, $999,390, and we appreciate that, we're operating the library with only $38,000 more than we got in 2008. During that time, we've implemented numerous cost-saving measures by automating routine tasks, forming partnerships that expand what services are available to our citizens, and using volunteers to contribute to our mission. We've also reduced our staff workforce by the equivalent of 3 full-time employees. All that without once cutting hours or services to the citizens of Macon County. But we have trimmed and we have economized all that we can. And without an increase in funding for the libraries, it's likely that we will need to cut our hours and services. And while we understand that it's an especially tight year for Macon County due to the property revaluations, it's also a tight year for the citizens of Macon County. And those are the people who come to the library to look for jobs, to take online classes, to build skills, to file their taxes, to research information about health and wellness. They come to the library with their children to create young readers and to help with homework. They come to the library to pursue lifelong learning. They come to the library to connect with their community. And we want to be able to continue to provide them with excellent service and convenient access. That is our mission. We know that you care about the library and the people that it serves. Please invest in the library in the community by investing in the library. To summarize, over the past 8 years, inflation's increased 10%, county funding to the library only 3 fewer employees than we had 8 years ago, but we have 5,000 more people with active library cards. We've asked for a 4% increase for the coming year, which amounts to just under $40,000. Our current budget is $999,390. We need this increase to replace outdated and failing equipment. We have copiers, printers, and many of our computers are 8 and 9 years old. Try using a computer that's 9 years old to provide vital services. They're out of service a lot, and that's frustrating for people using technology. We need to give our hard-working staff cost of living raises. Many of our employees, and I'm thankful that Jackson County is trying to catch up with Macon County, but many of our employees make $10 an hour for all the things that they do for $10 an hour. We've requested funding to provide a 1.7 cost of living increase, which is less than the county has recommended for its employees at 2%. Health insurance for our employees is going up 7%, and we need to comply with the Affordable Care Act and meet our obligations to library employees by continuing to provide them with health insurance, and employees do already pay a portion of their health insurance premiums. So I saw the figures that Mr. Brown presented for the first time this evening. I would like to note that, combine some of the figures of the operating funds with the debt service, the interest on the debt, the maintenance, and the utilities, and we certainly don't mean to suggest we don't appreciate that, because goodness knows we do. But if you added those figures, and you would need to for Swain and Jackson to get that 43.40 per capita, you'd have to add in what Jackson and Swain also contribute for maintenance and utilities to come up with that figure as well. So I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have. And again, I do apologize if our supporters communicated something that we did not. We were asking them to come out in support of the library, to indicate to the Board of Commissioners that we needed to see an increase in order to maintain our level of service. At no point did we suggest that you were recommending a cut for us. And I thank you for your time.
Where else do you get funds from?
We get funds from the state of North Carolina. We get funds from our friends of the library. We get funds from fines and fees. We write grants. We get some federal grants and some private grants. And we get a small amount of money from the town of Franklin, not guaranteed this year.
So the majority of your money, I'm learning.
I understand.
I'm just asking. Where does the majority of your money go? Is it payroll?
Yes.
Yeah,
personnel is the majority of our costs.
How much did the state touch over the last 2 years?
In non-recurring funds, we've lost to our library system over $50,000.
Another example is kind of we don't think that's what the state has cut or not. That's probably as a student a whole lot.
Thank you very much. I do appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Well, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, I'm disappointed. I expected to see my name in life, Narelle Kirkland, appearing before Commissioners.
We'll do that next time.
But to those of you who were not witness to some of my earlier presentations back in 2004 and 8 and so forth, I must tip my hat. I have been upstaged. I'm in a unique position to talk to you about the importance of our library tonight. Between 2010 and 13, I wrote a book about the First World War. I'm hoping it will be published this September, so you'll get a chance to see that it was there for real. I do not have a computer at home. I had to draw constantly on the resources and, most importantly, the personnel at the library. They were skilled. If they did not know the answer, they were able to locate someone who did, and I was able to keep trucking for 3.5 years. And to your staff, I'm very grateful. The resources on the First World War were ample at the library, and they helped me put my book together in a very good fashion. But along came this past October. I had to have an open heart surgery, which went very well, but the anesthesiologist really screwed up, and I came out of the operation with my left leg and my left arm paralyzed. I have had to learn to walk again. That's why, to your great relief, you have not seen me now for the past 6 months. but it caused me to completely change my life. All the things that I'm known for, participating in the senior games, bicycle racing, discus, hiking the Appalachian Trail, all of that's had to be shelved because I simply can't do it anymore. And there was a pretty serious period where I went through not knowing what I was going to do that was going to keep me going. And then I thought, well, what about let's go over to the library and see what I can come up with. And I came up with an entirely new project that caused me to visit all of the libraries in Macon County, the Waynesville and Canton libraries, and most of the libraries in the Asheville system. So I'm in a position to speak with authority that Karen Wallace is running the best staffed, equipped, and able facility in the surrounding county area, and we owe a debt of gratitude to her.
Hear, hear.
So I want to bring before your attention the two most important things to a person living in Macon County. The first is clean water. We can't exist without that. And the other is the opportunity to learn. Not just, we all know you're tremendously supportive of the school system, and we're grateful to you for that, even going up to postgraduate work at SCC and your coordination with Western Carolina University. But we in Macon County, as Mr. Higdon can testify, are adults of a vast range. We go all the way up to over 100 years old. We want to be able to keep learning throughout our lives. So maintaining our library, not just in the status quo, but an ever-bettering and increasing capacity, that's what we need.
Thank you.
We have Nigel and Melody.
That's his fault, doesn't it?
We do not have a whole lot to add. I think everything was so very eloquently. I would just like to say that I have this 5-year-old that's going to start kindergarten this coming fall, and I don't think we could have gotten ready without the library. And they are a major resource, and storytelling has been wonderful for the both of us. It's almost a way of life. But I wanted to.
Hey,
babe. How
you feel
about the library?
We're scared too, son.
I want the library.
Thank you, sir. Bill Van Horn? Thank you both.
Commissioners, thank you very much for allowing me to make a few comments tonight. I just wanted to, I just wanted to bring back to your memory the number of things that occur at the library. We talked about books, digital books, hard copy books, and that type of thing. But I know that you all realize how many organizations, blood drives, you name it, that uses the library facilities, uses their electricity, uses their water, and that type of thing. Besides that, I just want to comment from the Natahale Hiking Club, you know, a small organization. You're aware, obviously, of what we do in the community. But we, as an organization, use the library not only for our monthly meetings, but also for our monthly board meetings. And also representing the Appalachian Trail Community Council, the library has been a great supporter of the Appalachian Trail and the work that Franklin and the county has done to promote our natural resources. They run a special program in early spring called A Walking with Spring. They bring in and conduct workshops, guest speakers, children's programs, all related to our natural resources. And those are just a couple examples to help you remember the number of organizations that use the library and use their facilities. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dave. Anybody, that's all we had to sign up. Anyone else?
Mr. Chair?
Yes, sir.
If I'm absolutely.
What was your name?
Max Weston.
Max?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And last name?
West. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. As you've seen, there's a lot of support for the library, and a lot of people have already hit on a lot of the large things that I was planning on mentioning. You know, the library is truly one of the few community resources we have that serves the entirety of the community. We've seen that from serving the elderly, the children. Earlier this year, they put on the largest children's event that they have had in their history. Over 200 people attended. My daughter, you can see back there included, she could keep here all night telling you how wonderful she thinks the library is. We continue to see ever-growing numbers of people utilizing the library. They've recently entered into an agreement with libraries across the state that has only served to increase its value to the citizens of Macon County. From being able to order a wider range of materials and a wider range of ebooks. I can go, even if the library isn't open, I can go onto my computer, get a book any time of day or night. And as was mentioned earlier, as far as the budget, that we spend a little over $40 per citizen. I can tell you, I get a far greater value than $40 a year out of the library. And you do a great deal to support the library, more so apparently than some of the surrounding counties. But I would like to think that we can do better. And I would like to strongly urge you to find just a fraction of a percent out of the budget to continue to support what we need. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else who would like to speak? Yes, ma'am.
If I may, I'm a faeder, and I'm speaking maybe on behalf of the Nantahala High School Club, but also because of two constituencies that were not mentioned. And one is I have two granddaughters who are homeschooled. And I know that the library provides many, many services for homeschool children. They have special programs for them. The homeschool parents and kids meet at the library to carry on with what they do. And I think another thing that they also do is that they do a lot for our Spanish-speaking community, and that hasn't been mentioned either. I think that coming from a much larger place than Macon County is, I can speak and say with some basis that the Macon County Library is as good as I have seen in a city compared to a city that had millions of people. And I think that it is a very inclusive, welcoming, professional, and up to the highest standards. And I think that we need to look at all the services that they provide, which goes far beyond what we traditionally think of as a library. Thank you for that.
This initial, Karen's initial request with the county manager, we talked about that at the time, it was about 51,000 at the time. We did talk about that. The county manager informed me that he would look at all the budgets to see about an increase if possible. And had we plugged in like a lot of other counties, the 6% and 7% sales tax, we probably could have done that. But after leaving Raleigh at 130 today, you better be glad that we did not. So this is where we're at 40,000. I had a discussion with Ms. Wallace that what I encouraged her to do was that, depending on what happens, there's so many unanswered questions regarding our sales tax. If you look at the sheet that I brought back from Raleigh, it shows us losing about $1 million off the bat. So it's not good for us. So a lot of things, with all that being said, the library has so many positive things. Number one, they have the strongest volunteer organization of any other thing in Mexico County. I don't care what it is. And we should be very proud of our library. and we are. There's more to it than just the money. But on the money part of it, I think out of the $40,000, a lot of it is non-reoccurring. I have asked Karen to look if she can maybe babysit some of this stuff for 6 months till we see where we're at with our budget, with our sales tax. We're up in the altitude like all other counties. And then if it is non-reoccurring, just to come back at that time and address the library with her needs. That's what we talked about in 6 months. And I think this board will be very open to hearing that. We want to have copiers, some contracts running out on copiers out there and other laptops. But the library is going to remain strong and be strong. You can see that the county has committed to the library. It is committed. The county manager, I think, did the best he could on your budget, apparently, a lot of other budgets. And so, Mr. Chairman, I would suggest that, you know, as the discussion goes on, it's for this board, but I have encouraged Ms. Wallace, if she can babysit some of this stuff for 6 months, let us see where we're at, and I'll make no promises. But we certainly want the library to have good equipment for folks in this community, certainly. So, but that's the conversation I just want to relate to the board, the conversations that we had, and the county manager and I have, and you and I have had.
Does everybody understand, as chairman, I appoint one of these guys as liaison to different organizations, and Ronnie is your liaison, so he's the one that I talk to, you talk to, about these kind of things. I want to echo what he says. I think Macon County is very committed to the library. Don't think a lot of people, but there's a little bit of an assumption that we're going to cut the budget and or, and I know you didn't say that, but we got emails that said that.
A lot.
I appreciate your motion, but not from this misplaced. But we do support the library. I think the county continues to. If you look at the numbers the county manager put forward, we put the largest per capita expenditure. And agreed, if you take those other expenses out, if you take those upper ones you showed you, we get the largest contribution per capita of any county, so we're treated the library. I mean, there's no question about that. The other part of that puzzle is these same kids and parents have benefited from the library also benefit from Macon County schools. And we make one of the largest contributions per capita of any county in the state of North Carolina. For a couple of reasons, we have three high schools, and two of those are K-12. So we make a very large contribution to help locally pay teachers. So don't forget that. We've not cut Macon County school funding. Matter of fact, the 4 years I've been here, it's gone up every year. And it is again this year at my request. I've asked that we put some more money into the capital outlay. But I would concur with Ronnie that everybody understand what he's talking about, the sales tax. That the state's basically saying, let's take all the sales tax, put it in a big tub, and we're going to divide it up per capita. Well, that sounds wonderful. That, well, no, it's not for us, because guess who comes through here? Tourists and second home folks. They spend a lot of money here, and we do things that help generate that income, and we ought to have it. And it's unfair that folks in some of these larger cities want to take that money from us. That's exactly what's happening. Am I correct?
Well, this morning we met at 11 o'clock in Rock. We thought the bill would drop today from the Senate, but it did not. It appears now the Senate's going to roll all these things together, whether it be, of course, driver's education being cut, teacher assistance as well. You know, almost everything you think of that the House has put in their budget, we're going to roll this in, including the Senate Pro Tem has now come up with an 80-20 plan. Just to give you an idea of what, if that should pass, then we'll ball it all together, probably put it in one budget to negotiate with the House. We thought that would happen today. It did not. It will not happen tomorrow. It could happen Thursday. We hope not. We hope it stays. But they are taking off a week from 4th of July, so that's good. But what it does to Macon County with this new scenario, if it should pass, we immediately lose 8% of our total sales tax. That's the first year. And we're one of the few counties we lose every year, even in the 5-year cap. So when our population is low, but our sales tax, because of tourism, is up here, we're in that catch-22. The town of Highlands is a big loser, as is the town of Rockford. So those are some of the things that we're hesitant, and the county manager did a wonderful job. As far as our budget is concerned, we just include the 3% sales tax. And we hope that they, somebody wakes up and says, well, this is not right. We don't know. So, and if some of these counties that's based their budgets on 6-7%, Mr. Manager, do wake up one morning and real problems. So, but that's just a long way of saying that that's one reason that this budget has been very careful in every aspect. Just to give you a little insight.
And we don't have to come back in December, so we don't have the money to pay our bills. So that's been very conservative. With that said, you know, we are in the middle of the process. This is our hearing time. We listen to you. We're going to take probably the next week to 2 weeks, depending on when we meet again, to talk about this, discuss this, think about it, and then we'll go from there. So, anybody else to speak? And here, I thought we had some more.
Just to summarize what the changes you had recommended and show the real plan, I can summarize it.
Okay.
If we have suggestions or items, other items of discussion concerning the budget, do we need to do that during this public session? Because we want to item I wanted to discuss with Ben Ashcap with him.
We can, or you can do it as a commissioner, you can do that outside the public session. Is that right?
I think that might be.
Yeah. Do my change.
Power of the vote.
We keep on the same timeline that I've used. Basically, if you'll recall, their recommended budget with the changes that consensus was achieved upon, there were three changes. Funding for the Highlands SRO in the amount of $50,000. That has been included in the fiscal year 15-16 budget. 6 months funding for the Heritage Center at Coway School, $40,000. That has been included in the fiscal year 15-16 budget. And an increase to the community funding pool in the amount of $25,000. Those total $115,000. That will be brought out of contingency. The contingency in the recommended budget was $273,769. Removing that $115,000 worth of additions from the contingency line will reduce the contingency line item in the fiscal year 15-16 budget to $158,769. That is roughly $58,769 more dollars than we had in the contingency fund last year. We feel comfortable with this amount based on precedents, especially this year. We've been very watchful of that contingency line item. The fiscal year 15-16 budget with those changes is still $46,646,357. So we were able to make those changes without increasing the budget. And that is all the changes that I have for you for your consideration here tonight. Again, the bottom line in the budget stays the same. These changes were taken from contingency.
Thank you, Derek.
Yes, sir.
Anybody else to speak following the public hearing? We're still on the library. Well, just in public hearing, we're talking about anything. We're talking about debate. But public hearing for debate.
Okay, I'm the next
one. I've got you. Yeah. I've got you. All right. Hearing nothing, I would entertain a motion to close the hearing.
So moved, Chairman.
Sorry. A motion and a second to close the hearing on any discussion. Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. I declare the hearing closed and thank everyone that was here tonight. And we're still in discussion and talks about the budget, and it's not over until it's over. So we'll do that at a future date. We'll have to do it before July 1st, but our budget runs out then. Sometime between now and July 1st. But thank you. And if you're here for the public hearing and you want to leave, that's fine. If you want to stay, then that's fine too. Thank you for being here. Let me declare the board in recess for 10 minutes.
You don't lose track of things.
Call this meeting back to order. Thank you. Item number six is our public comment period. We have Noriel Kirk, while you're standing up. Just come on up.
I'm here.
Signed up to talk about solid.
In deference to the commissioners who are fairly new, last year I mentioned that at the current time we have an entrance and exit to the library and SEC campus that is in and out. I'm sure you all have been to visit that area for one reason or another, and you don't have to be in an SUV. You go to make that right-hand turn, and somebody is parked waiting to go out. Robbie, you ready? You're tipping way over, and someday somebody who isn't familiar with that is going to fall over. It's a very dangerous setup. I know it was designed to get vehicle speed down right away, and I concur with that. But there's a solution that I offered to the sitting commissioners before, that one of the temporary houses just before you get to that entrance exit has been removed. The driveway still is extant. Just extend that driveway straight into the intersection and make the exit simply an exit. I said the timing for this would be very appropriate when we do the expansion, when SEC gets more buildings and so forth. But I really think it should be something you address right now, because that a car that is exiting the library, sitting there waiting to make a left turn, and they literally do not know whether the person coming down is going to make a right turn into the library or go straight into the picnic cavorting area to go walking. And not everybody puts on their blinker. And I remember when I was 16, my father said, one of the first things you always want to remember, don't believe a blinker. So it would be something that would be very well worthwhile. Now, I assume that being active commissioners, you have had occasion in the last 10 days to drive on Siler Road. There's a brand new sign saying speed limit 35. We went through that fiasco on Sanderstown Road about 6 years ago when they reduced the 50 down to 35. The police were pulling over everybody on the road. They're just used to going 45, 50. And then we went through it again with the Depot Street extension, and that's now 45. Please, commissioners, contact the DOT or whoever made this error and get that speed limit up to 45. When you go past the library entrance, there is no road, driveway. The only thing that is between you and the shopping center is some sort of utility parking area where they're staging electric utility poles. That should be a 45 zone. Everybody's going to do it anyway. The last thing is, I'm sure you've had occasion to go into the shopping center where the Humongo store is. And that Walmart shopping center was designed so that when you are coming north and you're turning left into it, it's a very simple access. And the cars waiting to get out are not in the way. But if you're coming from the south or the library area and you want to make that right turn, there's this stupid, stupid bulge that I talked to Tom when he first had the place built and the manager, and I've talked to the town board run by Mr. Scott, and I said, this has got to go, and nothing has happened. And I've gone to the hospital, come back, and I'm recovering, and the damn thing is still there. It is a major hazard, because you must go into the middle through lane in order to swing around that curve. Just chop it off and let the right lane be dedicated on into the shopping center. That's it. You've heard enough. Do your job.
Get all the questions.
I agree. But as you said, those, I think, are all pretty much state DOT things, but we can, I have hit that curve many times myself, so I certainly agree with that. Thank you, Dr. All right, here's a record where folks spoke. Adjustments to approve the agenda, anything we need to add, delete, amend, or we have a motion to approve the agenda. I have one thing. Let's see, we need to do a request for the fireworks coordinator and the Franklin as well, please, and Franklin. So that does need to be according to state law. I believe that the county commissioners have to approve the show to take place.
I just became aware of those things when I got here this evening. You can go ahead and take some approval, but you may need some further approvals to take them in connection with those. And I can have that ready for whatever continuation committee that you agree to do this evening.
I've got them both here.
But there's a little bit more paperwork than just a simple approval.
You have a copy of these?
I did. I got those this evening.
Okay, well, why don't we just pass those to him? Is there a reason that we can't do that? Just
can we approve Chester upon contingent upon stating you're going to make the order for fireworks?
I think it's fine to let them know that
they should be the same thing we approved last year.
And there's an application, if you recall,
right,
where they submit.
Not to my knowledge. Okay. This is
they need to be submitted.
So contingent upon the application.
There's information in there you have to have in order to approve.
Well, what we approve this is let's put it on the agenda under UBS's 10E fireworks. My recommendation would be to approve those contingent on the county manager and our attorney's approval.
And I think you're going to have to take a little further action. I think you can communicate with
them. Anything else to add or delete? If not,
one item, I'd like to discuss the discussion of proposed reduction in environmental health fees for the budget year.
Okay.
And if we want to shift, we need to put some of the stuff that you gave us on the agenda.
Yeah, there are a couple of additional matters. Tommy Jenkins had approached me, if you recall, recently there was a cancellation or a decision agreement for Florette's lease. Upon that happening, Harmony House, which is another one of the tenants there, basically approached him and indicated that they would like to have the space that Florette's have, and that they would like to basically get their existing lease and that lease to that new area Florette's had occupied running together. So I talked with Tommy and he's talked with Harmony House. What I propose is a rescission or cancellation agreement that would be effective July 1 for Harmony House to cancel their existing lease, a new lease, a resolution in connection with that would basically describe the new premises, which would be Unit A at the incubator facility together with the space that 4X had.
We need to make that an agenda item. Let's make that 10F.
There's a resolution, rescission agreement, resolution, and
we do have that. Yes, sir.
In addition to that, I think we learned maybe late Friday afternoon that DOT was expecting some activity by this board in connection with the paving at Harper Meadows. And I've worked with county manager to put together the resolution that was required by DOT. You have that in your time as well. So I think that should be added as an agenda item. There's two other things that are in your pile. Don't necessarily have to be added as agenda items. They're really more for your information. There's a tower space lease for the Cali Ball Tower between the county, sublease arrangement between the county and the radio station. That's really more for your information.
We don't have to
for you to be looking at. Probably will be asking you to take some action on that fairly shortly. And then there's an interlocal agreement on the QZAP. Again, that's for your information.
Okay. Jim, I recommend we add 10E would be fireworks, 10F the lease industrial park in 10G, the paving at Harkin Address.
Mr. Chairman, on the transmitter building lease agreement, we do have the representatives here. They came tonight with anticipation. They're on a pretty tight schedule, so if we can allow some time to look over this, if you think that's appropriate, just because they're here and have any questions for them.
Okay.
I just request that they make an effort to be here, and they're the only ones really present that any of this stuff that Chester gives us.
Do we have to take action on that?
I don't think you're going to be able to tonight. The reason for that is it's effectively about a five-year sublease arrangement, and the sale and disposition statutes that the county's under are going to have to comply with, and I'm going to have to talk with Warren to see which method talk with the radio station to see which method. There's multiple options of proceeding. We need to find out what's going to be most friendly to the radio station.
Okay, we need to discuss that now with him here.
Proposed agreement, I think, has pretty well been seen by the radio station. They've had opportunity to comment on it. I think the only thing that maybe they have not seen were some blanks left in my draft dealing with the rental terms. And I've worked with Warren today in completing those. Otherwise, I think they have seen the document and know what's in it. And I think they have indicated their pleasure with that. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Anything we do with that tonight? Or do you guys want to say something? If we can stick, we put it on the agenda, make an agenda, that would be fine.
Sure. Is there anything to come up to this?
Well, while he's coming up, I'm going to be clear on the agenda adjustment. Did Commissioner Heaton add that? What time did we put the environmental health fees?
That would be new business. It's new business. Yeah. And let's make it H, and it's environmental.
So that would be fireworks.
E, yes,
the proposed
lease to the industrial park, 10F. 10G would be the paving from Parker Meadows, and then H would be the telephone.
Okay, and I think Lori had a couple items.
Sure, Dave. Under consent agenda, you already had budget amendments 217 and 18, and just need to add another number 224.
224, we got that.
Under consent, and then also we need to approve the agreement between the county and Senator Goldhauser. That would be our special counsel on the QSAP project.
Okay. What would we do that, Chester?
New business.
That's right.
Yes, we haven't talked about that previously.
All right, what do you want to call that one?
Bond counsel agreement.
And Mr. Chairman, also I'd like to request a closed session for the preserving.
Does that matter also a matter of personnel?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I think we've heard it. Anything else? Good.
Station, Sean, do you a little bit?
I think it would be appropriate to talk with them because indeed. I think this is a situation where I need some feedback from the commissioners as to is the board behind proceeding with this. I'm assuming it will be, but certainly y'all need to know enough about it to give me direction to proceed with that.
Okay. I don't mind that the beginning of the new businesses are here to do that. Anybody, anything else? Hearing none, I hear a motion to approve the agenda as amended.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor of the amended agenda, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. All right. Under reports and presentations. Do we have anything? I didn't have anything after that. Moving on, old business, we have none. New business, we'll go ahead and talk about the power of WNCC. Josh, we recognize you for any comments you'd like to make.
Okay.
We'll go from there. We'll move right to the top.
Good evening, gentlemen and ladies. Appreciate you listening to us here for a few minutes. What we're doing here is basically, and this has been sort of an ongoing project for the last 4 or 5 years, what we're looking at doing is increasing the coverage area to better serve the community for the radio station. As you know, we provide news, weather, sports information, you know, cover the county events, and this would basically allow us to better do that. Right now, with the present signal, which went on in 1965, it has limited coverage. It covers Macon County, but such areas as Nantahala, George, you can chime in at any moment here. Highlands also is another area that basically, and I know Jimmy understands that it just doesn't have the complete coverage area. What we would be doing is just leasing a small portion at the top of the existing 100-foot county tower. Understand from Mr. K that they've put up a new tower, the 70-footer. We would basically, and they'll be, I know, moving their antennas and such to the new tower. We would basically be leasing the top 15 feet of the existing tower in order to better cover and serve the community and county.
This conversation, Mr. Chairman, has been going on for a long time. We've been down this road with Forest Service many years ago, and it's good to come out again here. And we've had this conversation, Mr. Chairman, the reason that we're very interested in this is the complaints we get on snow days in Nantahala is worse than, you know, without. And in Highlands also, Jim. So that's really where it enhances the coverage of Macon County, because most people get their local news and such as school closings and such as that from the radio station. So that's where this conversation started. John, is that about correct?
It's been probably a 3 to 4 year conversation.
At least.
And that would give you better coverage area, I would say, in all of Macon County, give you little peaks and valleys, some places.
Yeah, it, you're right, Mr. Chairman. It will basically cityscape, I think is the proper term that we use in radio, all areas of Macon County, as opposed to I don't say limited coverage, but there are areas in Macon County basically that you just can't pick it up.
And also it will enhance the signals in Silva, Jackson County, and even over into Bryson City. So you'll have all the community events and all the stuff that we cover, the news coverage about Macon County, also getting out to all of those.
So with it being on Cowie Falls, you definitely get coverage.
It would enhance.
Because now there you can't, at least you got half one. When you cross Cowie Mountain,
right,
goes away, when you start back up Austin, you actually get the end.
Yeah, the existing tower, like Sean mentioned, has been there since 1965. Well, the tower's been there since 1957, but the FM went on in 1965 and 96.7. And it's actually, there's some people, and we joke about it, there's some people that live above the tower or, you know, listening and looking down at the tower, and you don't see that radio because it's in the bowl here. It's in the bowl of Franklin, and so it gets out as good as it can, but this would enhance. And also, if the board approves this tower lease, we're going to also move, well, simulcast, I say move, but it's going to be a simulcast on the FM channel 1050's programming, WFSC as well, and that's in the lease on an FM translator, which is the FCC. If you don't know what an FM translator is, it's basically a mini FM repeater, and they have a lot of rules that go into what FM translators can do. It can't originate programming, but it can repeat. It can repeat an existing FM station, or it can also repeat an AM station to enhance. And as you guys know, if you listen to the Braves or try to listen to 1050 at night, or Steve in the morning before sunrise, we have to power down at night to 153 watts, which doesn't make it past the Georgia Road.
And so it would enhance 1050's coverage, all the programming that's on 1050 available here on FNC. So it's a significant step. In times of disaster, especially when the power goes out, stuff like that, a lot of folks turn to the radio. When we had a
Thursday morning.
Yeah, Thursday morning. I mean, I was in contact with the superintendent. He was calling us every couple of minutes, it seemed, telling us what was going on. We were trying to gather what was going on. And stuff like that. It's going to enhance that. It's going to make folks be able to pick something a lot better because there's a lot of places that you can't pick up stations. That's basically what we've tried to do with you guys is meet in the middle, and we have kind of a back story. I know Ronnie knows about this, maybe even Jimmy Tate knows about this. We tried to lease space on a commercial tower on Cowie Ball, but the Forest Service doesn't allow anymore. Well, they do allow, but it's a long process of actually constructing towers up there. There's a number of commercial outlets up there, but most of them don't even want to consider it. Don't even want to talk about leasing it because it's theirs and they have, I'm sure, needs too. And there's a UNC TV tower up there that's owned by the state of North Carolina, but they don't rent to commercial outlets. So there's a number of towers up there, but we've just kind of been thrown to the wayside when we tried to contact them, tried to get anywhere with getting on their tower. And so that's why we contacted Macon County and Commissioner Beal and Commissioner Tate, because you guys were going through a communication study at that time and were enhancing your communications to the fire service and police and all that. So that's how this kind of got started, the communication got started, and that's what that is to this point.
Is it kind of like short form? There's nothing. I mean, I know you've read the lease. There's nothing here that interfere with the Lake County emergency transmissions.
Well, in fact, the way that the document is drafted, should it, they'll have to adjust the schedule.
Chester,
these folks have, from the radio station, have done exactly what they told you. They've met county halfway. They brought a document to us to look at. And unfortunately, when we started looking at it, we realized that we can only do what the Forest Service will allow us to do, because we don't own that. We have a lease arrangement. They're very sensitive to our concerns, and they were most open to making the adjustments that we needed to in order to try to be in compliance with the Forest Service, as well as the concerns that Warren voiced. First and foremost, that tower is there for emergency services purposes, and they've made the adjustments.
Chester and I are both okay with the provisions that have been placed in that lease, that it puts the priority on emergency communications, and they're willing to work with that, so we're okay with it.
Thank you. So we do need to approve this before it happens.
Yeah, but due to the length of it, you can't really approve it right now. We've got to comply with our sale and disposition statutes. If the board tells me to move forward with this process, I can get that process done. We should be ready to
come out with what you need, a motion, whatever.
I think just a consensus that you're ready to do.
With the changes,
that's fine.
Gary, you're okay with doing it?
Take another 3 years.
Well, that's one thing that Ronnie talked about. There is a timeline here, and which we've been working on for 3 years. They give you, we have what's called a construction permit for the permit we have at WNCCFN, and it expires November 27th. But it also entails some other stations that the company owns, like 104.1 and Clayton Moving Frequencies, some other stuff. But by November 27th is what we have to get it basically on the air. So that's the time constraint.
I don't think we're going to have any issues with that. With a little bit of luck, we can pay.
You have a consensus.
All the agenda for July.
You have a consensus to move forward. We're unanimous in that. So let's.
So while we're all together, do you think that whenever we have we can't have next year, you can come ready for that graduation, but you think you'll be ready at our next
One day, first next week. I think we'll be ready to go certain Friday. I think we're going to have to.
As soon as possible, by consensus, we're ready to move forward. So as soon as we get that done. Okay. Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Business, region list, there's 10A. June 2nd, we had an email poll regarding the grant for Calvary School. Mr. Mayor, do you want to hit the highlights of that?
Great, sir. Mr. Chairman. Department of Commerce awarded the Heritage Center at Cowie School an underserved and limited resource communities grant in the amount of $24,120 for improvements to the Cowie School music venue and facility. This includes upgraded professional sound equipment, stage lighting and controls, sound absorption treatments, theater curtains for the windows. This is block sunlight during performances, a more user-friendly website, and some more things for marketing, parking, just the whole gamut of improvements for the Heritage Center at the Cowie School. This again was sent out on Tuesday, June 2nd. This is another one of those grants that we're notified we have received, and it is a very tight submittal deadline occurring before the board would have a chance to meet again. So I did poll for it, receive a unanimous consensus, and we'll just seek tonight to ratify that action.
So I'll entertain a motion. Motion by Tate.
Second
by Bill. Any discussion? For discussion, also in that, let it be noted that there's plumbing improvements on the 12 working toilets in there. So we're part of that work.
Absolutely. And if there is no county match required, we will receive invoices for the different parts of this project and will be reimbursed by the Department of Commerce.
Now, we're moving the budget on in July. I'm about to say since we're so close to year end, we'll actually take the budget.
Okay, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. Department of Transportation right away purchase agreement. County Attorney.
Mr. Chairman, could we pull that from the agenda? We're going to try to present that at our next meeting. I apologize for not getting that in the adjustments.
Okay. We have, I know, a couple change orders with David Parker Meadows that would have already been covered in past financial.
Yes, this was in the $300,000 that was approved. And I guess meeting before last for additional cost of the Parker Meadows project, largely attributable to location of the grave site. One of these changes that was approved on there was a change order to the Penland contract. Penland incurred $48,000 in additional costs resulting from grading adjustments they had to make resulting from finding the grave site. The change order this year is in your agenda packet. The contractor's application for payment dated May 30th. This change order in the amount of $24,000 and $10,000 is included in this application for payment, and that, again, those were part of the approved funding at the last meeting. So just we've brought everything before the board throughout this project and approved all the change orders. We're asking the same thing.
I would entertain a motion to approve that change order as presented.
So moved.
Second. With motion, second by Bill. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. Fence.
Going right behind that is the fence order by AMT, or the change order by AMT Fence. AMT Fence is the fence contractor at the Parker Meadows project. This change order comes as a result, again, of the fence had to be adjusted as we had recessed the fields. Now the fence will be installed on top of the retaining walls rather than at grade as it was originally proposed, which has resulted in a change order in the amount of $10,720. Again,
This was included in the presentation on May 21st, and we were just seeking to just solidify that.
I'll entertain a motion to approve that fee exchange award. So moved. Then second by Mr. Shields. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. 10E is the fireworks for Nantahala and the Highlands. You have seen those. My recommendation would be to approve both of those, given approval by our attorney and county manager in the final paperwork.
So moved, Chairman. Second.
Got a motion and second. Any discussion?
I think the date on Nantahala is to be
Sunday, July 5th. All right. Any other discussion on approving fireworks?
Is Franklin and Good in there?
They are.
Franklin, right there. Might be the hitman.
Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. I hate to vote against fireworks. Next item, we have the lease agreement, as we mentioned before, at the industrial park. Man, do you have that, or Chester? The lease agreement.
Chester lease.
Lease agreement.
Thank you, let me explain.
For
Harmony House. In a nutshell, what you have is 4X. Vacated premises at the incubator facility. Upon that happening, Harmony House contacted Tony Jenkins, who has been managing the incubator facility, and asked if that space could be added basically to their lease. Tommy indicated to them that he thought it could, and they basically wanted their existing lease to absorb that area and get those things running together, because obviously they don't need one without the other. So I propose basically effectively canceling their existing lease July 1 and starting a new lease, which encompasses both Unit A as well as the space that's for us. Documents that you have before you, first the rescission agreement would need to be approved, and then the resolution with the lease attached to it.
Motion to approve the rescission of the lease agreement with the Harmony House.
Okay, we have a motion. Okay, we have a second. Any discussion?
Wait, just on the map there, is that blue currently? Let me tell you, just for your edification, the yellow area as shown on Exhibit A is the area that would be in the exclusive possession of the Harmony House. Because there are multiple different tenants in there, there's some common areas, well, just for other purposes, it's called common areas. That's shown as blue. And Harmony House would have the ability to use that in common with the other tenants. That's the blue area.
And the 4X is this?
Let me point it to you. 4X was actually this area right down in here, together with these common areas here.
Okay. So they're just assuming that.
That's right.
And you did that on a certain dollar per square foot.
What we did is we basically took the price, Tommy's recommendation, took the price 4X was paying for that, and added that exact same fee to what Harmony House.
Okay. Any other discussion on the rescission agreement? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. Now the approval of the new lease be effective July 1st.
If there's resolution basically making it surplus property that can be leased, the period 1 year.
Okay. Motion by Commissioner Chase. We have a second. Yeah, any discussion?
We're just glad Harmony House continues to improve the new way.
Absolutely. Play a part of that. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. We have the paving at Park Commanders. Mr. Manager?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. And I have Jack Morgan, who's doing a great job of overseeing that project out there here with me tonight. Basically, we had budgeted in the beginning and received estimates from the DOT prior to or during the planning phase of this project. We have since contacted the North Carolina Department of Transportation and firmed up those estimates for the North Carolina Department of Transportation to perform the paving work at the Park Commanders project. We have communicated with Wanda Austin. She is the Division 14 project manager. And in contacting her, she informed us that she would need a description, a cost estimate, which Mr. Morgan has worked in coordination with the DOT to get, as well as a resolution from Macon County in support of the project and outlining our intent to reimburse the department for their work. To get this agreement before the board on in July, Ms. Wanda Austin is requesting a signed agreement to Raleigh by next Friday. Now the agreement is different The agreement is different than the resolution that we're approving here tonight. The resolution is showing our intent. Wanda Austin is working to get that agreement prepared, and she should be sending it to us this week if she needs it by Friday. But in approving this resolution tonight, which also contains the description and the cost estimate, we'll be ready to sign off on that agreement when it gets here. If we also need the board to authorize me to enter into that agreement from the DOT once it gets here, as well as authorize us to pay 50% up front to the North Carolina Department of Transportation.
The resolution as drafted actually contemplated that we would be receiving a contract from DOT, state DOT, that we do not have yet. And I may have messed up. I think I gave our chairman the authority to execute a contract consistent with the terms of that resolution and the estimate. If it needs to be you, then we can certainly make that change to the resolution. When I drafted the resolution, I actually, I think I indicated that the authority would be given to the chair.
Okay. Are you going to be handy this week, Mr. Chair? That should be fine. Chester had also brought up, the point that we have considered other informal bids as part of this process. Jack, if you want to kind of go into the discussions you had. We're getting this for $5 a square yard. Is that right, Jack?
Yes. Maybe less, but they won't commit to that. Cost increase the 1st of June already, which directly impacted this estimate. If you look at their engineer's estimates, you should have a copy of that. That indicates that they will do the double mat seal, which is described in the paving process description. The fog seal, which is just the sealant to it, you can compare it to wood finishing, you put a stain on it, and then you seal it. So it'll be impervious to water. And then they're also going to paint the margin lines on the pavement, parking spaces, crosswalks, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, for the same $5 a square foot. We recently had the multi-use court paved. That's under Penland's contract, so we weren't directly related to the cost with that. But I did ask the Penland's what the paving cost were, and it's approximately $20 and something a square yard. That's compared to $5 that the DOT has offered. The DOT assures us that this is at their cost to be a good neighbor. That they're not making us an offer.
I understand there was also the inquiry made of a subcontractor as to what this exact cost is. Is that correct?
The first payment of the basketball court?
Yes.
Have given a price of 11? 10 to 40, they discussed it. And again, that is a square yard. That's $5 a square yard.
Versus 11.
So, to me, actually, this is a win for us. They're offering to do everything but the prep work, which they would normally do anyway. our grading contractor's already in the contract to have it. What did we agree?
What was our original cost estimate on that, Jack?
It was about $30,000.
It was, well, we had an original cost of, we had an original cost of $124,000.
So this is already in your budget?
Yeah. This just goes back to what was.
Plus, Jack, you've added a lot more since that budget was put. You've added a lot more parking than what that.
We have. This doesn't include painting the school overflow parking area.
Obviously, all of it was.
We were about 162. 60.
When we did this.
So that was as much as interest.
Yep. We have it. That again goes back to the last the May 21st meeting when we approved the additional funding.
If you've done any research, you know, I know if it's $5 a yard.
And that is including striping, fog seal, paving, that's everything.
It's a little different than an asphalt paving job. It's apparently it's very durable product.
Very durable. I feel take a minute to look at that.
If you want to take a minute, there's some material in that resolution.
It's ideal for parking lot.
It is.
We have you got your wheels on a hot day, it don't.
No, it doesn't care if I can.
It's not good for Warm Creek, though.
No, we get on more.
If you guys research and know, if you made a recommendation, I think that's all we need on that. Money's there. This is what you chose. We have to rely on your reputation.
So this is what we discussed with the day we're taking the hit, though, really, and it was $160,000
spent. I actually had some material cost for the day, and so there's a chance that it could even be less than this.
And with the paving, you say, well, why is paving so expensive? Well, I won't go into a lot of details, but the asphalt that they paved in the multi-use court was trucked from Rainsford. So if we were to do one contract now, we're going to have to pay the truck from Rainsford.
We need a motion. We need a motion.
We need a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion adopting the resolution giving you and or the county manager or whoever authority to sign off on it.
I think that would be good to give both.
And also, we approve paying half of it up front and for reimbursement.
And entering into the agreement.
We have a second.
Second
by Paul Hickman. Any discussion, George?
Any discussion?
I don't understand a whole lot of that you've seen before.
Yes. There's money there. I don't have a problem.
All in favor say aye. Opposed. That motion passes. Thank you, Jack.
Thank you, Jack.
Appreciate it. Commissioner Hickman wrote the health discussion, the health fees.
Real quick, don't want to get too much in detail, but I've sat on the health board for a number of years. I'm an ex-environmental health supervisor and regulator for 10 years in Macon County, and now been in the private sector 20 years. So this is something I know a little bit about. And I appreciate Derek's analytical approach to the library funding. That's never been applied to the environmental health fees, and people don't think much about environmental or Jack Lift. The building, Ronnie's familiar with all this, the building inspection fees, minimal to the overall cost of certain projects, but still certainly not in line with surrounding counties. Macon County's environmental health fees bring in about $100,000 a year. When they raised those fees 10, 12 years ago, they were trying to make it a self-sufficient program. Ain't no way it's going to happen. It's about a $400,000 a year program. Never going to pay for itself. Our fees, one of our fees is five times higher than Jackson County's fees for septic system permits. And I had a wild hair for a long time. When you do a pilot study of reducing those fees to nothing, but that's a little out of line. And I've met with Jim Bruckner, Kyle Jennings, the new environmental health supervisor, and we've tried to structure some reasonable fees. And our last conclusion was, well, let me bring it to the board, see what monies we have available. And I can justify, and I can give you a detailed report of our fee structure. I would like to bring our fee structure in line with Jackson County. Maybe not meet them, because theirs is very reasonable, but bring ours closer in line. But we've agreed that if to reduce our fees 50% would cost us about $52,000 a year. And sitting here tonight, I was looking at our contingency. What's left in the contingency, I think there's $158,000.
Yes.
And Ronnie and Kevin got to it before he got a chance last week. There's $158,000 left in there. Last year, our contingency was $109,000. So if we took that $58,000 and counted that as revenue, environmental health fees, we can reduce our fees and still not have to dip into the fund balance or increase the total amount of the budget. Or, you know, so I'm just making a suggestion. I've harped on this with health board for a number of years. We've got to get our fees, start with our fee structures and get them like. I don't know where we rank in the building fees. Ronnie, you build another cancer.
We're more economical than some from the West, and we're middle road, so we're higher than frequent.
But
we're in line pretty much with the field.
Our environmental health, our other side of wastewater, our well fees, which bring in about $40,000 a year, we're in line with Jackson County on that. I still don't think y'all have to pay $375 to get a permit to drill a well on your private property. That's just phenomenal to me. But to reduce the environmental health fees and the well fees 50%, would cost us about $75,000 a year in revenue, projected revenue. County manager had a suggestion of where can we cut at the health department. Well, as you know, all of these departments, they say they're right on the edge. So we can't look to it, but I don't think it's paying $75,000. I'm just throwing it up for thought. Ronnie's extremely familiar with this. When it costs $2,000 to get a four-bedroom septic permit in Macon County, that's phenomenal. That's five times higher than Jackson County. It costs $460 in Jackson County.
Do you know how much Jackson County, have you looked on, see how much Jackson County, what their budget is on it? Do they supplement the rest of it, or do they do it with less people, or what do they do with it?
I don't have an idea on it.
In the interest of time, I agree. I think we looked at it. In fact, I had a conversation this week, and I'm going to record to say, and I talked to some well drivers that are very much opposed to the process of having to apply. You explain what that is.
If you want to drill a well, they've got to come out and do all the evaluation, and I don't have a problem with that.
State statute,
but the fee structures, state statute says that you've got to have the wells permitted by a licensed agent of the state, which we have here in the county. And that's a good idea to keep you a certain distance from other wells, from septic systems, or sources of potential contamination. It's a good idea. But when we structured those things at the Board of Health, we had no analytical process. We didn't compare it to anything. We said, oh, that ought to be $375. Well, what was that based upon? It was not based upon any science or any analytical tools. It was just a good number. Like our septic system permit fees. How much would we charge for a three-bedroom permit? $500. That's just a feel-good number. It don't feel too good if you're out there trying to put in a double wide trailer and have to come up with $1,000. But, and the bad thing about the well program, if you want to repair your well, which a lot of times are your senior citizens or people on the lower income scale, if you want to repair your well, if it goes dry or you need to sink it deeper, you got to pay $375 for a repair permit. If your septic system fails in Macon County, a lot of times it's the older houses, you know, it's a $125 permit just to get a permit to repair your septic system. Jackson County, zero. Transylvania, zero. Clay is $50. So there's just some, I think, out of line numbers there. And if we were in impoverished county, let's keep them high. But we're not in impoverished county. I think it needs to be,
And I agree with what you're saying, especially with the well thing, and I think we looked at the whole fee structure, and since that involves not only the revenue and the expenditure side, I think it's that Derek was trying to get some kind of, we don't really have anything on paper, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I was prepared to bring some something up. Jim and I, Mr. Brooker and I looked at it, and I said, well, let's see how much money we've got to start with. I mean, but I really
Derek, you look at it, and I think my
think all is exactly right. I mean, I think all the police stuff, we talked about it before, is that really going to prevent most people from building a new house? No, but we're not in the new house stage. What Paul is talking about, where it really hits home, you got to do repairs. That's where it's really off. And I think Paul's agreeing with that. What I'd suggest is, like Paul said, I'd let Derek look at it. If he can find a place to cut, we can take some out of contingency that I'll be doing. I think this board will be moved this board to just address it, what we can do.
Yeah. And I applaud Derek for using this process on like the library. That's realistic. And I think we ought to apply that to a lot of our funding areas. Mm-hmm. I work with young and Derek. I know you got a lot of spare time.
We're happy to sit down. Did you say that you had spoke to Jim about it?
Oh, yes.
They are right now looking to their budget to see where they can make up that on the expenditure side. Because as much as we can make up on the expenditure side there, but, you know, you get into, they're still having to provide the same service, regardless of what the price is.
Yes, it's just too expensive.
So it's
a policy decision of whether the
players are concerned.
That's right. It's a policy decision. Is the county going to absorb more or less than that?
Exactly.
I think you have a consensus that we should look at that. I don't know if Derek can continue to try to get that done before we pass the budget. I think we're looking at maybe an amendment to the budget.
Yeah, in other words, I want to bring it prior to the vote on the budget was if we're going on big numbers, we didn't have that contingency without the plea. I appreciate your time on that.
Okay, thank you. Bond Council, I think that was that you?
Actually, Lori has a proposal that she has received from Bob Jessup at the Sanford Cole Council Fund. Bob has served the bond council for a number of years. Probably seen his number or his name come across on multiple projects and counties he's been involved in. Indeed, his firm has represented BB&T in a number of the financing arrangements, interlocal or local government financing arrangements the county has entered. In any event, in this CUSAP that we're doing with Highlands and Union Schools, there are some fairly complicated tax questions and opinions that come from that in order for us to hopefully get that 0% interest rate. And it necessitates getting an opinion from bond counsel. In this case, Corey was able to communicate with Mr. Jessup of the San Francisco Housing Firm with a proposal which she and I think both would agree was a very fair proposal, certainly given what we had paid for other bond counsel.
Do we have an interlocal agreement done with the schools? I don't. Where does that stand?
The interlocal agreement is on your table in front of you.
I thought I saw that.
But
where is it?
We're not taking action on it tonight.
Probably action taken.
Not done?
It's not ready.
Okay.
The bond council made recommendations for changes that we received today.
Okay.
So it's not ready to go. I think it's very close to the end.
Are we still on time?
That's what I
would. I submitted the LGC application today. We are supposed to be on the July 7th agenda. I've done my part. What's his name? Mike Watson has run ads without bids. So hopefully all goes well. He did his work properly. We've got to make sure the schools have their 10% match, and they're like Chester
said,
these tax implications have to make sure.
All those things are not done exactly right, then you're not going to get that answer. Right. And it will be charged back to you. at market rates as opposed to that nice 0%.
Market rate,
four.
It's probably in the four.
And rising.
Yeah, and rising.
Is your recommendation to approve the special counsel?
Yes, we said.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to approve the special counsel.
First motion, second by Shields. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion is passing. I believe that all the new business we had, is that correct?
Yes, sir. Do you think, Jeff, that, that we'll have the interlocal agreement stuff ready?
As quickly as I got the comments today, they went to John Henney Jr. at the school
board. He has to get back.
And he has to get back to us. I don't see any problems with that. We do need to probably circle the wagons with the representative of the school board to make sure his right hand knows what the left hand is doing.
I mean, with the children available.
Moving on, the consent agenda, the items that were presented on there, the minutes, budget amendments 217, 218, and we added 224.
219 can also be in
there. 219.
It's not printed also on the face of your agenda, but it is in the packet.
Okay. Have anything you'd like to remove or a motion to approve those minutes and budget amendments? Motion by Tate, second by Shields. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. Moving to our appointments, we have the several either currently to take care of or coming up. So back there, we have the planning board first. Let me mention we've got. We have eight applications for planning board. We have two seats available. We can handle it any way you guys would like. We can.
Is this one of those?
There was an application from Kathy Tins that was submitted after the agenda package.
Was that mine?
That needs to be added to this.
I believe that's Becky Raymond Richard, Creighton, James Wright, Jake Griffin, Jimmy Goodman, Robert McGrath, Thomas Young, and Kathy Tins will never be. I think that would be.
Could be eight.
That's a total of eight. Okay, so we need to fill those two slots. We can do those one at a time. We can do, if you have a motion to do two, if you want to do a poll, everybody can write down what they want to do. However you want to do that.
I'll make a motion to call Mr. Goodman. Serve in the past.
Okay, we have a motion to put Jimmy Goodman back on the board. Do we have a second?
Second.
A motion, second discussion. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of that, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
No. So that vote should be so. No. That motion failed 3-2. Thank you, Mr. Tate. We have other motions for other candidates.
I'll make a motion. Two, and we're going to do it for 4 minutes.
I think that's up to the board. I probably.
We're losing two females, and that's what it is. I'd like to recommend Becky Rainey and Kathy Kinsley. I
would recommend you vote on them separately.
Okay. I would say, actually, we've done that.
Everybody do it separately?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, wait, buddy, for one.
Okay, where's Becky Rainey?
Okay, we have a motion to add Becky Ramey to the planning board. We have a second motion.
Second.
We have a motion to second. Any discussion?
Which 46?
Is it at large or is it at Highlands or
front? Neither.
Both clerk's answer or clerk's ranking. And they both expired May 15th, so we both open now.
We have a motion to dismiss it. Motion second for Becky Ramey to be appointed to the planning board. Any discussion?
I know it's here.
We have her in those eight.
Six, seven.
Let's see.
Maybe two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. It would be nine, including her.
So including, so I had noticed that she would, do we typically have to do that? The people who are serving, want to be served.
Okay. Yeah, she is eligible to go back, I would say. She is high.
Susan's
wrong.
Yeah, Susan's turned out. Yeah.
Because her term limits. Okay. Good question. Yes. Note that we had a total of nine applications. We had Becky Ramey's name is on the floor. It's been seconded in discussion regarding Becky. Hearing none, all in favor of Becky Ramey being appointed to the planning board, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. We need one more.
Make a motion to Kathy Hensley to appoint to the planning board.
Okay. We have a motion for Ms. Kathy
Hensley
to be appointed to the planning board. Discussion regarding her.
I'm not familiar with her, so I'm going to trust y'all.
She talked for Gary.
She's on the water. So with that, we're saying Mrs. Patterson's not going to reserve.
She's on what?
She served the board.
I mean, I understand.
If the board votes, then she wouldn't, Mrs. Patterson would not be.
So what else? We're not offering further nominations. We're just doing one at a time. And to fill the seat, then we'll be in order of nomination.
Or two seats. And we, you know, if you vote this one down, then you move on to somebody's not familiar with you.
Well, I just think that courtesy of Peggy Patterson. Gary, he's on the planning board. He's the liaison.
I know she misses a lot of time or she did when I was on there. I haven't been to any planning board meetings lately.
Okay, we have motion second for Ms. Kathy Kinson to be placed on the planning board. Further discussion?
Do you need some additional information, Mr. Taylor?
All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Simply because I think Peggy should be able to get an opportunity out of public.
Okay. Noted that one stand up. That passes. The jury committee term of Sue Walter, Bill Martin, and Lynn Higdon expired. These have all asked to be reappointed. Are there other
okay. Motion to approve those who have applied, Ms. Walter, Ms. Martin, and Ms. King.
We have motion to discuss that. Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. The Airport Authority, Mike, I guess these are, they're talking about this, is informational because we do not go through an application process really for the Airport Authority. No one has applied. Mr. Rhodes and Mr. Jenkins have both expressed their willingness to be reappointed. And these are 6-year terms, just to be quick.
Okay. Yeah, Richard was, he filled in.
Peter Fathers. Yes, Mr. Rhodes was filling the expired.
Harold's term had expired.
Expired term.
Sorry, I haven't said this before we get into this, so I've got to ask all of you, even as liaison of the airport. Are they on term limits too? Do they follow, or is that different?
6 years.
Right. I didn't know. I mean, like the planning board, we've got two terms. So
this,
so on the airport, I'm just asking.
The RP has a different set of rules.
I am not aware of the terms.
statute. I'd be happy to look at that.
I know when we passed that 2 years ago, 3 years, whatever, about terminals, I know.
That particular action dealt strictly with the county planning.
But by statute, we nominate people to authorities.
The state statute dealing with your authority does put that responsibility on the commission.
How about the liaison? I bet he's going to have a great job there. They have 10 meetings regularly. And they're very helpful in their ability to do the work. So I would follow up. Make a recommendation for reappointing both Richard Rose and Tommy Jenkins.
Okay, we have a motion to reappoint Richard Rose and Tommy Jenkins. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes. We have the Social Services Board, term of Lisa Leatherman.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I should have requested that be pulled from the agenda. I'm doing a little checking. The way that's the freedom of the board, the way it's set up, Ms. Leatherman is actually appointed, her appointment comes from the other two members of that committee. The member who's appointed by the Board of Commissioners will be here at this time. And he has just recently been removed. That's my mistake. Sorry.
Okay. So we will remove that one. So I can request the Board of Health. Paul, we have Ms. Molly Phillips, and she's the general public appointee, I suppose, and Shannon. Stacey Shannon, the pharmacist, expired June 30th, 2015. Send the recommendation to him to go forward.
And I didn't ask him to head off to office. I missed the last four helping of the Board of Commissioners. I don't know if they want to reserve or not. We need to find that out, though.
We could reappoint them. Contingent on if they wanted on their
and chose not to, then we
hope. And customary with what the board appoints someone, we send that letter out and then we give them the option if they can't accept it, then they let us.
Motion to approve.
Okay, we have motion to approve Molly Phillips and Stacey Shannon to the Board of Health. Any discussion?
Yes.
Secondary second, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That motion passes unanimously. We do have a request for a closed session. Let's discuss. We have the media here. I don't think we're going to have sorted up.
Are you going to recess your meeting?
Yes. Yes.
You might want to notify.
Yes. Let's talk about when we're going to recess. Gentlemen, I think we'll take the information we've been given and study on this and come back in at the appropriate time to discuss finalization of the budget.
Does it have to be on Tuesday night, Mr. Chairman?
Next Tuesday's the graduation.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. But the next,
what about the 15th?
We need, if we could, we need some time to get our year end stuff.
When do you recommend we
be? I would recommend the 23rd. I can't be here. How about the 22nd?
That's
what we do. How about the 24th?
What about the 25th?
I'm good with all of them. 25th?
So you guys can't do 22nd or 23rd?
Yeah.
Okay.
25th? Oh, that's okay. I mean, I'm back the 25th. I'll be back at 5:30.
25th is on Friday?
Thursday.
I've got an iPhone, I just don't have a reading.
22nd,
Sam? Sam's
good. Paul, we're going the 22nd.
You've got to go on the 22nd, Paul.
22nd, 23rd.
I'm on the 23rd, 24th, 25th, but I'll be back after the meeting. I believe our crew will be back.
They were three.
So we can meet Thursday evening or Friday evening.
Thursday. And by the way,
just throw up a Friday night and see if you know.
Put on your calendars, everybody. On the 25th is Major Andy Shields' retirement. Long-term employee, and then on the Friday the 26th, James Kinsey return. So, yeah, make sure those two are on your agenda. Presentation for both of the three starts from 2 to 4. James is at the community building.
6 p.m.
Andy's is at, where am I?
I'm going to have to say, I've got the full
open. Is that
Andy's is on the 25th at
it's usually from 2 to 4 with presentation to 3. I know James is 2 to 4. I think that's right. I've got emailing here somewhere, but yeah, hers is at 3. Today in Raleigh, a lot of folks will be coming from Raleigh for James' retirement. And of course, Andy Shields is the longest serving law enforcement officer in the history of Macon County. So we certainly want to give him a.
What time is that?
It's usually 2 to 4 with the presentation of the. Andy's 2? Okay.
Who's on? Both of them on 25th?
No. James on the 26th.
James is on the Friday.
It's almost 70 years of experience.
Okay. What time is James?
It's usually from 2 to 4 with presentation to 3. Is that after this?
First may be a little longer.
First may be a little longer, but run around 3 o'clock.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Maybe Shields is the be bet. If you run at 3 o'clock, no, it's a feature to go home. Right, Mike?
Correct. It's 2 to 4.
All right, Thursday. So next media will be next, let's see,
maybe
a week from Thursday. Thursday, June 25th, 6 p.m., 5 West Main Street, and we will recess the board. Primary business to be consideration of passing the budget and any other items that might come before the board. Okay. 6 p.m.
Be action tonight. There may be a few.
Well,